Hi, and welcome to the first episode of Deconstructed, the Top Chef podcast, the only podcast that breaks down the food of Top Chef. I'm Sam Chen, and with me is my co-host, Peter Letterman. How's it going, Peter?
Hungry.
Hungry, hungry, Peter?
Always hungry.
You haven't only had donuts today. I feel like I need
more. I brought those donuts.
I know. We should have had some shrimp and grits.
Yeah. Although it is about to be lunchtime, so.
Hey, there we go.
Yep.
Just a warning, and should go without saying, we will be talking about spoilers. So if you have not watched the first episode of season 14, then go watch it first.
Or if you like being spoiled, listen to the podcast first.
Peter likes being spoiled in more ways than one.
Well, actually, you saw the episode before me, and I kept asking you who was going to win while I was watching it.
And I was like, no, like that's not how this works. No. So here we are, first episode of season 14. So season 14 is kind of interesting because it's got eight former contestants, chef testants, and eight new chef testants.
Or as I like to say, eight losers and eight newcomers.
Some of those losers have lost multiple times.
They have. It looks like Casey's lost at least twice, right?
Yeah. Oh boy. No, that was my favorite part of the episode when John gets here. He's like, look, Brooke, you're the only one who didn't have to pack up your knives and leave, but you still lost.
Yeah, you still lost. Still runner up.
Yes, it's great. We'll probably hop in to talk a little bit about the what we think of the chefs while we go through the individual parts. But basically, the episode was split out into, it was a big quickfire episode. That was it. It was just like one big quickfire elimination.
Right, a quickfire with like a follow-up.
Yeah, or a sudden death quickfire because there was an elimination. And so they split up the eight new chefs, and they got a version of the quickfire, and the bottom one went to the cook-off. Same thing with the new chefs. So if we want to get started, let's talk about the first quickfire, which was the new chefs. And their challenge was basically to make whatever number of chicken dishes they wanted to within an hour. And they could serve it whenever, so whenever one part of it was ready or whatever, they could try it out immediately there and then. So what did you think about that? I mean, chicken's obviously a very, like, fundamental, basic sort of thing that you can do so many things with. What were your, like, hits and misses here?
Well, I think a lot of them sort of fell into the problem of having too much freedom almost. You know, certain creativity comes from when you're limited a little bit. So they were just given a chicken, which can be, I think, really daunting when your brain's flying and you only have an hour to do anything. So I think we only got one person that did two dishes, right? Just Sylvia?
Yeah, I think Sylvia did the pasta dish and then something later on. I think Jamie technically did two, but I don't think he served in between because I think he had a...
No. He was doing that grand mère with his breast, I think, and he burned his vegetables.
Oh, that's what it was.
Right, yeah. Okay. So, yeah. I mean, we could talk about Jamie. I mean, Jamie burned his vegetables and he over-browned his butter. I think he should have just played that off and done something a little bit different with it. Had something a little more rustic.
But he didn't serve it, right?
Oh, did he not even serve it?
I don't think he served it.
Oh, okay.
In that sense, I think he was smart. But I think, like, you go to the station, you can smell that something burnt. Or you can at least
if it was really burning, which is probably the case, I guess. But, you know, the way they showed it on TV just looked like really good fond.
Oh, I have no qualms about the fact that if Jamie had served burnt vegetables, he would have gone home.
Yeah, I think so. Sure. I think so, too. I think Jamie played off well. And I think that Jamie also sort of got a little bit of a benefit of doubt because I think Tom seems to know that he has more talent in him. And it wants to go
that's
right
true.
Away. He kind of alluded to that. What were some of the other big controversies? Oh, Annie's not quite panzanella thing?
Yeah.
She claimed it was panzanella. That was not panzanella. I think I agree with Tom. There was a bunch of croutons with some fennel.
Yeah, I kind of feel a little bit bad because I feel like Tom is essentially like can sense the personality of the chef to not be as confident. And it's basically coming in and saying, like, hey, you're not confident. Like, why is this not a panzanella? Or why is this a panzanella?
Well, that's fine. I mean, to be the top chef, you got to be a confident, commanding chef. You know, it's not top cook. It's not top, like, you know, hobby craft. It's top chef. They need someone who commands and has broad knowledge. One of my least favorite things when I go to a restaurant or just someone's house or anything and they serve me something, they tell me it's something, and it's obviously not that thing.
Yeah, that's true.
It's horrible. I mean, it immediately shows you have no command of the culinary, you know, dictionary.
Yeah. No. It's funny. I do a very similar thing when it comes to like Thanksgiving or, yeah, especially with Thanksgiving. I basically, people are like, well, what can I bring? I'm like, look, I will make all of the staples because I feel like relatively confident making them. You only bring something if you actually want to bring it. Like, don't try to whip up something random. Don't like go out to the store and buy something. Like, just bring it if you actually know how to cook.
Right. Right. And especially don't call it something it's actually not.
Exactly.
No, I mean, and you know, the thing is, I think she probably knew better. She looked very embarrassed.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I just think it's a tricky situation.
She was holding back tears, for sure, for sure.
She was definitely holding back tears. So if you're going to make something, though, and call it a panzanella, and it's not a panzanella, though, it better be amazing.
Yeah. So let's talk about the ones that that ended up doing a lot better, which I think was Jim, Sylvia, and then Emily? Was she in the top? I can't remember.
I don't think Emily was in the top. She made that biscuit sandwich that was kind of falling apart. That wasn't particularly pretty, but looked quite
tasty.
That's right.
She was just like, well, you didn't say it had to look good. And they're like, you should rewind. Yeah. That's exactly what Tom said.
It must have tasted really good.
Yeah.
Do you want to talk about Jim a bit? Because Jim's was interesting. Well, when Jim described his food and when Jim gave his background, I was very, very skeptical of Jim.
Yeah.
He's basically a glorified private chef. I mean, he's a private chef. He works for the governor, you know. And he wanted to make chicken livers with a strawberry vinaigrette, one of the most, like, played-out 1990s, you know, like, catering food kind of thing.
Sure.
With ranch dressing. And I think that, I don't know. Like,
I don't know if he served it with ranch
dressing. He didn't, but he was talking about that at the beginning.
He was trying to do, like, three dishes in the beginning.
Oh, right, okay, so another one of them had ranch dressing. Yeah, but these are still the kind of things he's talking about making. Mm-hmm. And, like, I think my, like, little, you know, inner monologue food friends in my head started having a panic attack.
Well, see, I feel like, and I had a little bit of a different opinion on Jim, and a lot of it's more about thinking about culinary, like, progression in a very theoretical sense, where I think most people get some sort of exposure to some level of food that makes them want to cook and be passionate about it, and then as they kind of grow into it, they start getting really good at a couple of things, right? So it's not, like, all over the place. It's usually a couple of different cuisines or types of food, and then later on, you do the exploration, and that's how, like, essentially your food becomes your food because you've explored other cuisines, taste, techniques, and things like that. And I feel like he's, in one sense, doing it a little bit backwards, right? Like, he maybe didn't go out and get really good at one thing, but he maybe had, like, maybe a little bit more of a diverse palate, and he's, like, medium tier on that. That's what I'm hoping. But, again, we're one episode in, so, like, maybe he, you know, and but. Maybe he got lucky.
I'm a little skeptical of anyone who makes strawberry vinaigrette, period.
Sure. I'm okay with that.
Let's talk about his dish, though, too. He put out fried livers and fried hearts, and I think one of Padma's complaints was that he didn't put out any other parts of the chicken. Yeah. I'm totally fine with that. I think what the show didn't focus on at all, though, was how he actually prepared those things, because it showed him as just kind of breading and frying these things that.
Right, which makes me feel like every other, like, fried, like, liver thing that
I've
ever had.
Well, you can't do that with livers and hearts, so especially hearts. You have to soak hearts in something and get all that ironiness and minerality out of it. So he must have done those kind of things, which definitely shows that he's a chef who understands how to cook.
Yeah.
And he understands the different parts of the proteins he's working with. So I think we'll get some more to see out of Jim. Also, it's plated beautifully. That was a really elegant dish.
Yeah, for what it was, yeah.
Yeah, and he created an elegant dish out of the kind of food, the kind of parts of the chicken that are usually reserved as scraps or that, you know, were eaten out of necessity.
Yeah.
And I always love when chefs can elevate those kind of things well, not when they just sort of throw some awful and that's their kitsch thing. He actually elevated something very well.
Yeah, because you could see, like, I think he, like, went around and was, like, asking people, like, are you using your innards? And, like, if they didn't, like, he'd grab them. So, yeah, I thought in that sense, like, that's what probably impressed me most about it, was that he was taking something that, like, just isn't not necessarily normal, but isn't the parts of the chicken that you would tend to elevate normally, right?
Or I mean, chicken livers are a rustic thing. You see chicken livers on a lot of menus, but they're always done in a very, very, you know, rustic way. Tuscan, you know, chopped chicken liver on top of a little bit of baguette or something. You know, you don't see it terribly elevated often.
Yeah, so I'll say this. I think so. Jim did win with his innards and the strawberry vinaigrette. I think the one person who was actually cheated out of a win was Sylvia, because she
made two dishes.
She made two dishes. One of which was pasta, which people go home for all the time for either not making fresh pasta or, like, poorly making fresh pasta. She's Italian, so I guess she really didn't have an excuse if she did mess that up. But I think that was part of my thing was early on they were like, we're giving you chicken, something basic, but we want to see like how much you can do and how much you can learn from time constraints. So I was kind of surprised that she didn't get it with two dishes that they both liked.
Yeah, but do two Hyundai Accents equal one Ferrari? So you have two cars, but are those two cars as well built as the other car? Yeah. You know, that's sort of where it becomes the thing. It's you know, we're the sum of her parts altogether, even with two dishes, equal to the sum of Jim's one dish part.
No, and I agree. But my bigger point is the fact that Tom at the beginning is like, we want to see how well you work under pressure and time.
I think that is true.
And so that is definitely true.
But with that said, maybe again, even at the time and pressure, though, maybe under that time pressure, he still produced a better thing than either of her two other things. The problem with doing two, especially when everyone else does one, is you're obviously not going to be penalized at that point for only getting one dish out, because everyone else is only getting one dish out.
Yeah.
But if you put out two dishes, there is more chance for one of your dishes to be bad.
Yeah, and that's happened a lot. I mean, how many times have we seen on Top Chef where they're like, "You did this part of the dish was good, this part sucked. So if we just had the first part, you would have been fine." Right. But you gave us this like piece of shit.
Let's look at Sylvia's food. I mean, she did a pasta that Tom said was under seasoned.
True.
It did kind of look under seasoned, actually. Even looking on the screen. I mean, obviously we can't taste it or anything like that. But it looked kind of boring and bland. I mean, there aren't a lot of chicken-based pastas in Italy for a reason, because chicken is not a particularly bold flavor, and Italians like to have salty, you know, very flavorful things. She should have probably just added more salt. I think that's what it came down to with that. And then the second thing was like some chicken over like a corn salad. It looked nice, but again, neither of those things were any kind of interesting food that most home cooks couldn't whip up. I'm sure her pasta quality was excellent.
Yeah,
as an Italian, like even when we'd go to like friends' houses who were just home cooks in Italy, their food was so far leaps and bounds beyond any of the pasta quality we get from any restaurant in the United States.
Exactly.
So I'm sure her pasta was delicious, but I think there was a problem with her sauce.
Yeah. So we've talked about the top. Let's talk about Gerald and his poached chicken thingamajig.
that just kind of looked like a hot mess on a plate, didn't it?
I think it was, he got a little bit in his head. Because I think he fell for the trap of like, oh, let me make two things, you know. And then by the time everything was said and done, he realized he didn't have good components to even make one good dish.
Gerald might be a great chef in life. Gerald can work on recipes. Gerald can be given recipes, any number of things, and probably perfect dishes. The thing about Top Chef is it's not about if you're the best chef in life. It's if you're the best chef who can think on their feet.
Yeah.
You know, if you're the best one who can handle under pressure and these random things being thrown at you. And you know what? Not everyone's great at improvising.
Right.
Maybe that's just where Gerald fell down.
Yeah.
Because he lost twice tonight.
Yeah.
I mean, anyone was going to lose twice tonight who went home. That's just how the game works.
Yeah. Yeah.
But, Literally.
All right. So let's talk about the second quickfire, which was the returning chefs. So their challenge was from Graham Elliott, who seems to be the new Richard Blaise this season as a host.
He seems to be, yeah.
And I like Graham, so that's always good. It was 30 minutes to do a shrimp and grits inspired dish. And I think right away you saw like the biggest difference between the returning chefs and the new chefs, because I feel like most of the returning chefs tried to do a little bit more out of the box of a standard shrimp and grits, which I think if you had given the new chefs that, they would have just fallen flat.
Yeah, I completely agree. You know, I made the joke that it was the losers versus new chefs, but you know, this is where you see that actually some experience really does come into play, because all their dishes were much more interesting. Yeah. They also, though, didn't have that stipulation that they could make as many dishes as they want. I think that must have created some serious panic in that first round. If I was told that I could make as many dishes as I wanted and I was given one protein, I'd probably sit there for the entire hour just thinking about what to do.
You know what? But that's the thing. I think I expect by this point that chefs who come on the show have at least watched the show before.
That's totally true.
And so I expect them to be like, you know what? To me, the middle of the road version of that argument is I make one dish and I make it great.
Right.
Like I won't. That's my middle of the road, which I think, like, if you were on the first episode, the first episode, I think, is perfectly legitimate to aim for the middle.
Right. I agree. So I completely agree. And you have to remember that also, these guys, they didn't just have the experience of doing this once. It wasn't like something where they were on Chopped once and now they're right. veterans. They were all let go relatively late in their seasons.
Right.
So they've gone to do probably 20 quick fires each.
Yeah.
You know, if not more. They've gone through this many, many times. This wasn't like their second time going through a small rodeo. This is their second time going to a big rodeo.
Yeah. I mean, you put it in perspective, losers, it's like 10 to 1, right? Like, it's 10 wins, maybe, to 1.
These losers won a lot, to keep in mind. Yeah, exactly. You know? And some probably did get immunity during their... They did get immunity during their seasons and things, so they weren't losers. They were constant winners who then at some point lost.
Yeah, exactly.
They just weren't undefeated.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So...
Let's talk about their food, though, because that was there were some really interesting things that came out of that kitchen, weren't there?
Yeah, so my most... The interesting thing that I... the most surprising thing that I had from that one was actually Sheldon's dish, right? The dashi poached shrimp with kind of miso grits. Because on paper, it sounded like pretty good. It
sounded great on paper.
And then you got to the judging, and that's actually what they said. They said it sounded good.
Right, Tom said the exact same thing.
But then I tasted it, and it was like it fell flat. And so that really surprised me. I'm kind of curious how that probably worked out. Do you think it was just... the flavors were kind of like the same.
He's promoting his dish with things that are the base of savory and flavor. Dashi broth, basically. Yeah, dashi, exactly. Dashi is umami. You know, when people talk about umami, they're talking about glutamates, and those glutamates are heavy in dashi.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, dashi's made with kombu. Dashi's made with, could be made with dried mushrooms. Dashi could be made with, one I like, you know, is ones that are made with bonito flakes, which are the dried tuna flakes. So you're expecting something that's so rich in flavor. I mean, the thing that he had, and then he also added some yuzu to it and miso.
Yeah.
If anything, I would think that would be a dish that I would taste and say, oh my God, this is too much.
Yeah.
You're just taking all those Japanese buzzwords and sticking them into one dish and not realizing how strong each of those flavors are. I guess he just underused them.
Yeah.
He just didn't make a good dashi.
That's true. Like, my first takeaway was, I wonder if he would have had more success if he had done something with the shrimp to, like, kind of essentially, like, fry it up and give it more of a crunchy taste instead of, like, because I could see how this quickly could get into a more, like, almost like a porridge.
Like a one-note kanji kind of thing.
Exactly. And those work when they have, like, a big... punchy contrast to them.
Well, he should have had a big punchy contrast. He's adding super salty with the miso, with this sort of that deep, you know, salt flavor. He's adding brightness with the yuzu. You know, he's getting that really good citrus. I mean, yuzu is the super citrus.
Yeah.
Yuzu is like all the citruses rolled into one. Yeah. It's like a lemon, lime, orange, grapefruit.
Yeah.
You know, he should have so much flavor coming out of this thing. And you know, I cook a lot with those flavors too. You know, I almost consider some of those flavors played out because a lot of the young chefs, you go to their restaurants and it's the same thing. It's like these, like the Japanese flavors modernized. But the reason it happened was because those flavors are great and they're bold and people love them. You know, I like to make fried Brussels sprouts sometimes with miso and yuzu. You know, like I do a lot of stuff with dashi. Dashi is the basis for a lot of my cooking.
Exactly.
But because there's so much flavor to it, there's so much vibrancy. So if you were offered something with all those keywords, basically all those keywords of Japanese things basically equate to flavor. Here, I'm giving you a big bowl of flavor, and that big bowl of flavor doesn't have any flavor, you've significantly failed in that dish.
Yeah, yeah. So let's talk about some of the other ones that actually probably did a little bit better. I really liked the concept behind... Well, actually, I didn't necessarily like the concept, but when the judges judged it, it was Shirley's bowl of hug. Egg custard type dish, right? Because originally she's like, well, I had egg custard growing up, and that was like, you know, shrimp and grits is like a, like, kind of, not soul food, but like a...
Yeah,
like
southern home, staple, comfort food.
Comfort food. And that's what she wanted to bring, and I was like, okay, that could be interesting. And then what surprised me was when the judges were like, well, it actually had a bunch of punch to it. Like, it still felt like comfort food, but then it had a little bit of a kick, and it was, they said it was like getting slapped in the face and then getting the bowl of hug, you know, like... So that to me, I think was the standout about what Shirley did.
Well, I'm a sucker for most Asian egg custards. I mean, be them, you know, the sweet dessert custards or chawanmushi. Like I love egg custards.
Yeah.
Shirley knows what she's doing. She showed that in her season 2. And she's cooking things like egg custard, which she knows how to do very, very well. And I think Shirley should stick to that because she's cooking things that are so perfected already with hundreds of years of history, and then putting the smallest twist on it just to make it a little bit better. Rather than letting her ego, you know, go full force, she's just making very, very, very good food. And then twisting it slightly to elevate it. And it's perfect. She has such finesse in her cooking, it looks like, to understand that.
Exactly. And I think that's the point that I don't think you got from the new chefs, is that, like, not only is it about concept, but it's also about, like, execution and technique of, like, taking something that maybe not the easiest thing to just adapt and being able to make that small twist, I think is key.
There's always so little drama with Shirley when they edit those shows. And they don't even show her that much because I think she is just so calm and knows exactly what she's doing. When you have such a great grasp of the skill needed, then you're able to do this little tweaks to make something great. Because that's when the artist can come out.
Oh, yeah.
And the artist can say, you know, I'm gonna tweak this just a little bit, but I have so much skill behind it that it's still going to be delicious because it's not going to be completely conceptual.
Yeah. It's interesting you say that because that, for me, as someone who's a photographer, that's one of the key points that I think a professional photographer is. The difference when you pay for a $500 wedding photographer and a $2,000 wedding photographer, in my mind, is you're paying for consistency. Can that $500 guy get really great shots? Probably. But, like, when there's a curveball, when the rain hits, when something else happens.
Still on top of it.
Yeah.
And you still get a great product.
That guy's going to panic where the pro is going to be.
Yeah, right, exactly. The pro's going to be right on top of it.
Boom.
She's great at that. She's, like, the best of a few different roles. So she's, like, the contemporary artist that can't paint like a master, you know? So you have a contemporary artist who just paints a big color field, right?
Yeah.
And it's great in concept. It's wonderful. But they could never paint a Da Vinci. They could never paint a Michelangelo. She's like the Michelangelo who's, like, mastered her technique and can now do something conceptual with it.
Yeah.
So you get, like, the best of both worlds. You get actually elevated food rather than new food that's just, you know, comes from nowhere or old food that's just boring. Yeah.
So speaking of letting the ego get in the way, let's talk about John, who was at the bottom for the returning chefs with his, like, Korean shrimp and grits with kimchi and whatever dish, which, to his own, like, admission, was something that he's kind of done before that he's kind of rehashing again.
So we're seeing a difference then between him and Shirley. So I was just praising Shirley for doing something she knew how to do. But she creates something new. What John did was he took a completed dish, a dish that, like, works in cohesion by itself, and then just added some things to it.
Yeah.
So Shirley based it on an old concept.
Right.
And then created a new dish out of that. John didn't base it on an old concept. He based it on an old dish.
Yeah.
That's a different story. That's like building a new car based on, like, a beautiful old car. It's an all-new car, but it looks like this grand old 1920s Plymouth or something. Was Plymouth even around the 20s? Who knows? But you know what I'm saying. Like, it's a brand-new car made to look like a grand old car.
Yeah.
Whereas John is taking, like, a shitty car and just adding a bunch of stuff to it to try to make it a better car.
Yeah.
Like, he's taking an old 1980s car and just adding some stuff on it to try to make it a better car.
Right. Yeah.
So that's not going to work. We don't want to talk yet about his next dish.
No,
do we?
We'll,
okay.
We'll get to that when we talk
I think about I think John deserved it just because it was such an – or deserved to be on the bottom. I didn't even taste his food or anything, but just the idea of what he did would lead to failure.
Yeah.
That's just understandable. He didn't think about adding the new components as enhancing this. He just thought about adding new components to a dish he already had just to get them on there because he already knew it was kind of tasty before.
So let's talk about the person who won immunity from the returning chefs, which was Brooke, with her kind of shrimp scotch egg.
I think she won for two reasons. The two reasons go hand in hand. Not only was it something that the judges thought was tasty, it did look very tasty. She executed it perfectly.
Oh, yeah.
She conceptualized, executed, and made something tasty. Yeah. I mean, that is very well done, especially with something so, so finicky as using an egg. Yeah.
So why don't you describe for people what the basic concept of a traditional scotch egg is?
So a traditional scotch egg is you basically take a soft-boiled or hard-boiled egg, at least an egg with a firm enough outside that you can put something around it.
Yeah,
and you usually put, like, pork or some kind of beef – or sorry, some kind of meat around
Usually
egg.
Like a sausage.
Yeah, a sausage. Exactly, a sausage. Yeah. Sorry. Some kind of seasoned pork sausage. And then you roll it in whatever, you know, your breadcrumbs or your flour or your eggs, and then you fry it. So you have sort of this, like, meatball with – fried meatball with – an egg in the middle.
Ah, so good.
So we are going to never agree on that because I hate hard-boiled eggs. So the majority
I don't want it hard-boiled.
Well, exactly. Okay, so that's sure. Where I agree with you. So like the traditional Scotch egg to me is kind of gross. Yeah. Unless it's done with a soft-boiled egg. But so many of the ones you get have those hard-boiled, nasty eggs inside.
No.
She cooked hers perfectly. Perfectly.
Yeah. And this is because I asked you when we were watching the
episode. I would eat hers and love that.
Yeah, because she basically does the soft-boiling, but then she covers it with shrimp.
Right.
And then cooks it just enough so the shrimp is cooked. And
what she inadvertently made, I think without realizing, was she made a shrimp toast, basically. She made like a really good shrimp toast with an egg on top. Because she basically ground up shrimp, seasoned them, put them in some kind of, you know, in a breading of some sort. She used grits, which is brilliant because she's getting the grits right in there. Shrimp and grits right on top of each other even.
Yeah.
So she's basically already going that direction. And then she puts the egg in the middle. So she's made basically a modern take on a shrimp toast.
Yeah.
And it looked delicious.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's great.
Yeah.
It was great.
No, very, very clever, you know. And again, she's someone just like Shirley who looks so calm when she's executing. It just, and that's why it goes to plan. That's why she can do something that's a little bit more complicated with so many different steps.
And that's where, like, I think, you know, you brought up the point earlier about having 60 minutes and being in your head. And in contrast, having like 30 minutes and having to do stuff with grits, which could take that long just to cook. I think that's the biggest thing is like, because you see in the episode, Brooke seems very neurotic, right? Like she comes in, she's like, I don't know why I'm here. Like, can I leave? But the thing is, it's like, once you get past that and you realize I need to put out a dish in 30 minutes, like that actually makes it easier because you're just stripping away all the stuff that you can't possibly do and focusing on what you can do.
Yeah, no, that's, she is great at that. I think it's actually good that she's someone with a brain that races a million miles an hour all the other times because it means that she can constantly just think of really out-of-the-box things, it looks like.
Yeah.
Like making that egg, which was really, really brilliant. Yeah. I mean, she understood. So when they were going to that competition, Casey, they had an interview with Casey, and she was saying, how can they expect us to make grits in 30 minutes? It takes at least 30 minutes to make grits.
Yeah.
What she wasn't thinking was that this competition makes you think outside the box. And that's exactly what Brooke did. She thought outside the box. She said, you know what? I'm probably not going to be able to make grits, creamy grits in 30 minutes. So, you know what? I'm going to use them as a breading to fry instead.
Yeah.
And you know what happened to Casey? Casey tried to make traditional grits and failed miserably.
Yeah.
She made one of the dishes that they liked the least. I think it was because the grits were undercooked and not good.
Yeah. Exactly.
So if you look at a challenge and you say, hey, there is no way I can do this challenge traditionally, don't then try to do the challenge traditionally. Think outside the box. And a bunch of them did. Yeah. Shirley did. I mean, Brooke did. John, I guess, got cooked grits somehow.
And the thing is, I feel like at the end, it's all, no matter how, like, and I've seen this because I'm a big reality TV show fan, so I watch Survivor and all these things, and you see just how much being eliminated on the first challenge, like, avoiding that means to people. And so they do things that are, like, probably, if they really came back and thought about it, they wouldn't do. Like cooking an old dish, like taking it a traditional way. Because these guys are coming in and thinking, like, how do I middle of the road this in a different way? And that's just not going to get it done on this.
No, I mean, Gerald, I just think he was just in over his head in that first round. But the thing with Gerald was that he basically cooked family meal. He just cooked kind of something in the allotted time.
Yeah.
So he went total middle of the road, which got him to the bottom. Because you can't do middle of the road, it seems like, on Top Chef anymore.
No.
Maybe the first two seasons. Like, the first couple seasons, it seemed like you got to advance if you didn't mess up.
Yeah.
You know? Because you had line cooks on there. You had caterers on there. You had people who weren't really used to being under a super high-pressure kitchen situation. Now that's not the case anymore.
Yeah. No, I mean, and it's kind of like this. I don't know how much of a golfer you are, and I don't want to keep using sports metaphors, but it's like the idea of lag putting. Right, so there's a concept that basically says instead of shooting for the hole, you shoot just past the hole, because a bunch of your shots that would fall short would probably just fall in the hole.
Right.
Right. And so it's kind of like saying, like, you're gonna swing for the fences, but you know that if you don't hit it out of the park, you're still gonna get like a double.
Right.
And so that's the basic concept, and I think that's where you look at some of the, like, chefs who didn't do well in this one, and that's what they couldn't do. Is that they came up, they had this idea, and then when something didn't work the right way, they were completely short. They were out. So great. So let's hop into the the elimination, which was kind of an extension of the quick fire, and that was the oyster roast. And so we had John and Gerald kind of competing. What did you think of? Well, first of all, what did you think of that as a elimination challenge? And then second of all, what did you think of their dishes?
I thought that was a great elimination challenge because it totally brings in, you know, the low country cuisine of eating oysters and having oyster roasts. Mm-hmm. And I think it was a good elimination challenge because I like what they're doing on the show now. They're not giving them too many constraints. They're saying, here are a bunch of oysters. We want you to do some kind of oyster roast. And that really lets them open their minds. You're not giving them an ingredient that's so esoteric that they haven't worked with it before, but you're giving them something that's a little bit tricky, but you're not putting any stipulation on it. So we're going to get exactly what kind of chefs they are out of it.
Yeah.
And I think we saw that a lot. I think we saw a very experienced chef put out a very experienced dish. And we saw a very young chef put out something that looked tasty.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's the thing, right? So John basically did the exact same thing. He pulled something out of his bag of tricks and used it as a safety net. Because he's like, so he used black truffle, which is, I guess, one of the ingredients. You can bring ingredients with you, and he
brought a truffle. That's almost like cheating. I mean, I like white truffles better than black truffles, but that's still almost cheating.
Yeah, and you heard him say it in the episode. Like, they're like, oh, you pulled out the truffle. And he's like, well, yeah, like, I'm not going home episode one. Like,
right.
I'm gonna use this truffle.
But it's not cheating, because some people actually don't like truffles. And you know what? You can use truffles very, very wrong, incorrectly.
Yeah.
So, yeah, he brings out a more expensive ingredient, but it's still a relatively, well, I guess you can't call truffles too controversial, but it wasn't like that was going to give him the win no matter what. It's just another flavor he brought out.
Yeah, and I've been on both ends of that as well, of, like, whether it's with, like, truffles or something like foie gras, like, where if it's not done well, like...
Right, if you just hand a piece of foie gras to someone who's most experienced in the kitchen is cooking burgers in the backyard, you're going to get one of the worst things you've ever had served to you.
Yeah.
Without question. So it doesn't matter if you have the greatest ingredient in the world. It's not an automatic win. You need to know how to use it correctly. If you put those truffles on top of the mignonette that, like, Gerald made, it would be disgusting, obviously.
Right.
So even the best ingredient not in the hands of a great chef is not going to be a great ingredient. So I guess he didn't cheat too much.
Right. So let's talk about kind of the techniques that were utilized, because I'll be quite honest, the majority of my experience with oysters is like raw or fried, like two very, very diametric ends of the spectrum, but also like basically not anything that's like got any nuance in cooking. So these guys took different techniques but cooked the oyster. So let's talk about John's, like, cream-poached oyster. Like,
John semi-cooked the oyster.
Yeah.
John cooked the oyster by just using the residual heat of the cream to cook the oyster. But he also did the best job of getting all the flavor out of the oyster as a result. Because he's getting all the liquor out of those oysters that he just put in to cook steep with the cream. And then he's getting all that flavor out of that really nice raw oyster. Because you don't want your oyster being too cooked, actually. I kind of like that idea. You know, at one point Tom said, ooh, it's raw. But I don't think Tom was actually necessarily criticizing it. I think he was just expecting a more cooked oyster.
Right.
So I think his cooking technique was excellent there. I think it was a very clever way to do it. And he brought it out of a bag of tricks. If you're going to – who is Woody Allen always said, if you're going to – don't steal. But if you're going to steal, steal from the best.
Right.
And that's exactly what John did.
Yeah.
John took it out of his bag of tricks, but he didn't take it out of his bag of tricks from, you know, a chef who is mimicking something else from the French in New York City. No, he took it out of his bag of tricks from the French, from the source. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. It's going to be delicious. But you know what? This show, it's not saying who's the best inventive chef. It's who's the best chef. And if you can understand and curate those great recipes from the past, then you're a great chef.
Yeah.
And you absolutely can make what you're going to make.
Yeah. And I think that's where, if you look at a lot of these shows and, you know, people complaining about shows where it's not a real reflection of how skilled you are at any given thing, whether it's cooking, shooting, doing whatever, I think that the key element is you have to take away and you have to remember, at the end of the day, if it's really plain, it's not that interesting to watch.
Right.
Like, they're making a television show to make it interesting to watch. And I think Top Chef at least has done a pretty good job of finding that balance of making it interesting in a gimmicky way, but also like staying true to what cooking actually means.
Right. John really did go back just to the roots of what cooking actually means. It was, do you see how simple it was what he did? I mean, really, all he did was steep some oysters in cream, put some oysters in the bottom, and then shave some truffle over. He looked like he put a little squeeze of lemon. I'm sure there was salt involved. You know, right. There were probably other things involved that we didn't necessarily see. I'm sure he seasoned it well. But that is the prime example just of a simple dish that technique has made so perfect. Mm-hmm. And I think that was a really great thing. Gerald's was more experimental, I guess, but not really, because Gerald also just pulled out from old cooking techniques necessarily. Yeah. He grilled oysters and he put what he thought was a traditional Thai sauce over it,
right.
Which was not a traditional Thai sauce, by the way.
I mean, I think we saw Gerald get a little bit mixed up because he had cooked the oysters and then they had crabs in them and he wasn't going to serve them with crabs, and then he cooked more oysters and that kind of caught him off guard. Like, I mean, in this situation, why aren't you just cooking more oysters?
That was one of the most painful things to watch, because not only did he not cook enough oysters to begin with, I can understand making that mistake. You're in the moment, it's in your head, you're not thinking clearly. I'm going to cook four. But then when you open those four up and you see that there are crabs in them and that it's not going to work out, he then went back and put four more on. At that point, wouldn't it dawn on you to just dump the whole bucket onto the grill, because you might not have a great shot of getting a good oyster? I mean, clearly his oysters were fine afterwards, because they didn't bring that back up.
Yeah, and they
ate his oysters.
Yeah.
But Gerald seemed in a little bit over his head that entire episode.
Yeah.
And even with the Thai sauce, that was a very amateur kind of Thai flavor sauce. There were no interesting chilies in there. There were no bird chilies or anything. If you're going to make a Thai sauce too, and you have special ingredients you can bring, well, I guess, first of all, I don't understand why he didn't dig into his special ingredients.
Well, maybe
you better bring some of those.
I don't know. Maybe he didn't have anything that was
There's nothing interesting. There's no galangal in it. There's no there should have been some mint in it. So if I was going to make that mayonnaise, I would have, and he put no lime in it, there should have been some kind of lime, even kaffir lime, leaf or something in it would have been really interesting. If I was going to do that mayonnaise he did, I would have done lime juice, fish sauce, shallots, bird chili, and maybe a little bit of brown sugar or honey. But I feel like just from hearing his ingredients, it was – did I say fish sauce? There has to be fish sauce. Everyone should take note that fish sauce has to be in Thai food. His ingredients were fish sauce, vinegar, and honey.
Yeah.
Which you're getting a little bit of that Thai salty, sweet, sour flavor, but it just doesn't seem right because the heat is what rounds it all out.
Mm-hmm.
And we also didn't taste it. For all we know, it was very, very cloyingly sweet. I mean, I just watched a cooking professor. It was at UNLV.
Yeah.
And I was watching him on TV, and he's teaching them how to make Thai shrimp. It was literally sugar and shrimp. This doesn't exist in Thailand. And I think a lot of people need to understand that Thai cuisine is not based around sweet. We've understood it to be based around sweet, just as we assume Chinese food's based around sweet in this country, because that's what was introduced to us.
Yeah.
When really, there's so much more complexity to it. And it's also much more based around salt and sour than sweet.
Exactly. Sour.
Sweet's a complementary thing to Thai cuisine. It should never be the forefront.
Right. And that's to be honest, what I like about Thai cuisine is that, it is the addition of sweet on top of something else to give a little bit of contrast and a little bit of just a unique thing to the palate.
Thai cuisine, Mexican cuisine, Filipino, I mean, so much of the Southeast Asian cuisines. I want to start listing the countries. A lot of Polynesian cuisines, like Guamanian food, which I just started getting into. So much of them are built on all these contrasting flavors that are all very pungent.
Right.
Sweet, salty, sour. They're very strong. And they came out of necessity because you kind of had to hide certain things that probably didn't taste as good. So you get powerful, powerful flavors. And they're great. But if you're going to do them in an elevated kitchen, do them really powerfully still. Make it still a real punch in the face. Don't do something that just sort of tastes nice or is very mellow. That's not what that cuisine's based on. When you have chefs who've elevated things like Thai food, like Ming Tsai, for instance, who does stuff up in Massachusetts.
Right.
He's been around forever. I ate at his restaurant years ago, 20 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
He elevated Thai food, but he never forgot about keeping those super bold flavors in it.
Exactly.
That's really important.
Yeah. No. That to me is always when you talk about different foods and cuisines and how to elevate and do this, that's the thing I think a lot of people just get lost in, is that they end up trying to take a flavor and apply a completely different approach to it. And that's not always the way that you can build that fusion. Sometimes it is about having that existing flavor and then just doing what kind of Shirley did and just
Right, exactly. Small spin. You have hundreds of years of tradition. Don't change it. Just maybe manipulate it a little bit, but let those hundreds of years of people saying, ooh, that's delicious, and millions of people saying, ooh, that's delicious, don't mess with that. Yeah. You know, like, you know, a million people can't be wrong.
Yeah, well, that's what it is. It's like, figure out what works and what doesn't work, and then take what works and build on that.
Right. And I think we're having an excellent debate on the philosophical underpinnings of making a great dish, but I actually don't even think Gerald really thought that far.
No.
I think Gerald saw some oysters and said, you know, I'm going to make a tasty little Thai sauce to go, and a tasty little Thai me in that. That'd be good. Those kind of flavors of Thai food go great with you know, cooked or just slightly cooked oysters. Yeah. But he didn't understand what we were just talking about to create a delicious mayonnaise.
Yeah, and I think he course corrected the opposite way, right? Like the first episode, he said he got too much in his head, and then
he didn't get enough in his head. Yeah. In this one. Yeah,
and to be fair, it's 20 minutes, and I think that's the interesting thing is like if you took Top Chef and we had like a parallel universe where in the parallel universe you get 5 minutes to think and not do anything, and then you start cooking. Right. Results could be completely different.
Yeah, his thing was just way too simple. It was underthought, not overthought. But I think the first one was kind of underthought, too. And I think that's one of the problems you kind of had with Gerald.
Yeah.
You know, if you're going to do a Thai roasted oyster thing, make something really big out of it. Make like a nam tok, which is like where you take the meat and you mix it with rice powder and all those bold flavors. The mint, the chili, the lime, the shallot. Do a big, nice, beautiful salad of that. Not a big salad, you know, not like like an Elaine big salad from a diner, you know what I mean? Just like create something with lots of different ingredients and flavor. But really, he just made an oyster with a nice mayonnaise.
Yeah.
I can go to any more modern chef-driven restaurants and get a nice oyster with a mayonnaise.
Exactly. All right, great. So that's probably all we had for the stuff in the episode. So let's move on to our segment, Chef Testament of the Week. Which we really haven't decided what we're trying to focus on, whether it's funny, sad, whatever.
This isn't the person that we think is the best. This is like the person that we like to watch this week.
Right.
It was tough this week. I think the first episode is always tough making a decision like that because there are 16 chef contestants.
So many.
It's a lot to choose from. And they get so little airtime each.
Yeah.
We see so little of them.
Yeah. Yeah. So for me, I think like in the intuition for me is Jim because I just like who he is. But I think it's probably going to be Emily for me. And it's just because she seems like an instigator in this season. That she's just like, they were running around. They're just a bunch of turkeys. And
you can tell right away that Emily's going to be the drama.
Yeah. I'm not going to make friends with them yet because I don't think I need to. Here's the thing. If there's anything about watching this show, it's taught me that the personality of the chef probably doesn't have a ton to do with the food. Like it does in a sense, but most of these are still as successful as they are still younger in their terms of their career and their life. And so to me, I think there's the opportunity to be a complete asshole and still be really good in the kitchen.
Yeah, I completely agree. We had it with Marcel. Yeah. Marcel was very talented in the kitchen. I would never want to have a conversation with the guy.
Oh no. Yeah. God.
No, there are lots of people like that. Emily might be one of those too, you know? Just because someone isn't exactly socially, you know, brilliant doesn't mean they're not brilliant in their creative endeavors.
Yeah. All right, so how about you? Who gets your vote this week?
So I was thinking about giving it to Annie.
Okay.
For no reason. I couldn't stand Annie, the panzanella, you know, thing. But I feel bad for her. She almost cried. But she's not getting it. There are no pity chef testants of the week. So here's my other one. I'd want to give it to Brooke. I'm not going to give it to Brooke, though.
Yeah.
Brooke cooked a really brilliant dish.
Yeah.
And she executed it really perfectly.
Absolutely.
I'm going to give it to Jim.
Okay.
Do you know why I'm giving it to Jim?
Why?
Jim's description of his dish was something that I was embarrassed for him. The strawberry vinaigrette thing. It comes back to that. That sounds like something a caterer would make.
Sure.
It does not sound like something that an innovative professional would make. When he put out that dish, the way it looked, the way that apparently, you know, Chef Colicchio and Padma said it tasted, I'll give it to him. Because if he could make something delicious that I just thought on paper sounded so lame duck.
Exactly. No, agreed.
I'm giving it to Jim.
Sure. Yeah, he's the opposite of Sheldon in this episode. Yeah.
Yeah. The exact opposite of Sheldon. Sheldon put out something that should have tasted delicious. He had all the modernist culinary buzzwords of ingredients. Jim did not. Jim was like, back in like, you know, bathrooms that have glass block in them kind of era.
Yeah.
But he made something that was delicious. So I'm giving it to Jim.
All right, great. So your pick is Jim. My pick is Emily for being a disruptor.
Those are very interesting picks, I got to say.
All right. So let's move on to predictions. And since it's the first episode and we do have things broken up, why don't we go for predictions of on both sides? Who do you think is going to be the first former contestant out? Who do you think is the next new contestant?
Oh, the first former contestant out?
Yeah.
Ooh, I don't think John's going to be first. He was almost first. Okay. I don't think he's going to do it. I think he's hopefully going to learn from his mistake of using an old trick thing. He may have just been flustered in the first one.
Yeah.
Because his dish that he made to not get eliminated was so excellent. Yeah. It was so brilliant and just such a chef dish.
Yeah.
Definitely not Shirley. Shirley has it all together.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Katsuji's a wild card, but I think he's going to stick around. Brooke's sticking around. I think Casey's going to be the first to go. It's either going to be Casey or Sheldon.
Okay. I could see that.
Yeah, Casey or Sheldon is my prediction.
Yeah.
Sam's going to stick around for a while in the background.
Yeah.
Sam's going to stick it right in the sort of the middle, maybe upper middle for a long time until it finally gets whittled down and he's going to go because he's not going to be as talented as the others.
Yeah, see, and for me, like, it's Amanda, and it's for a purely, like, innocuous thing. Because she did have one of the top dishes in the quickfire. She was one of the top three.
She did.
Yeah. My thing is, she is completely... I do not remember her from season 7, DC, right? And if I don't remember her at all, she did not leave a mark, and she left for a reason.
I'm sure... Well, everyone here definitely left for a reason, but yeah, I can understand what you're saying.
And so, to me, not to pick on her even as what she made, I think it's going to be her because I feel like that's how TV works.
Do you know I think it would be her?
Why?
I hate people who add raisins to those kind of dishes. It's just going to be her because of raisins.
There you go. Raisins. Okay.
Yeah,
raisins. How about the new chefs?
New chefs.
So we already lost Gerald.
First to go. Well, we already lost Gerald, yeah.
Yeah.
I like Silva. I like Jamie. I know Emily's sticking around because they kind of edited it in a way that we see her having breakdowns in the future, unless that's just next episode.
Yeah.
I think it's going to be Annie.
Yeah.
Annie's Panzanella thing, it's not just the Panzanella faux pas itself, how she reacted to it. I'm not sure Annie's got what it takes to stick in this.
Yeah. No, I agree. Like, there's definitely benefit of the doubt to see what she does next week. But yeah.
There's no crying in baseball and there's no crying in the kitchen.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Chopping onions, no crying. So to me, it's.
There's a lot of sweating in the kitchen that looks like crying. Do you see Katsuji in that episode?
Yeah.
His food was probably plenty salty because there was enough sweat that it went in it to, like, you know.
Oh, God. Oh, God.
Dry up a sea.
Yeah. So I think spiritually, I will say it's probably Annie as well. And then kind of like the honorable mention for me is kind of BJ.
Yeah, BJ's a bit. I don't know enough about BJ yet as a contestant.
I don't know enough either. I feel like he got lucky with this one. And by lucky, I mean, like, chicken is in his wheelhouse. He executed and created something that was fine, right?
Right.
And I think that, sadly, will get you pretty far in a lot of seasons. I don't know if it does in this season unless they keep...
Especially with the veterans.
The veteran... Unless they keep the newcomers and veterans separate for a while, I don't see it.
That'll be interesting to see. I could see him doing better if that was the case, but I agree with you. He doesn't seem to have the very fine chops as the rest of them. He's been doing a barbecue place or a couple barbecue places, and he definitely trained in a very fine manner. But we'll see how that sort of his approach to doing food more rustic way will actually play out for the rest of the season.
Yeah.
Jamie didn't get lucky. So Jamie would think got lucky because he messed up part of his dish, but I think his concept and the rest of it was so elevated that he actually earned his place in the competition. That's especially true. If you do mess up something. If you mess up something and you're still in the competition, you must have earned it with everything else.
Sure. All right, so how about kind of MVP? What's your prediction, at least right now, for who's going to take it off?
Overall of all 16, or are we just talking about
all 16,
one
all
and one?
16. And I'm the only reason I say all 16 is I'm looking forward to when the switch might flip that we trust some of these new chefs, because I'm not going for a new chef.
All right, so let's break it down. My top four right now.
Top four.
Top four.
Oh, God, I can't even.
It's so early. It's Brooke, Shirley, Silva, and Jamie.
Okay.
absolutely, without any question, those are my top four. When I say he's going to be taking it, I think it's going to be Brooke.
Yeah.
Right now, my prediction is for Brooke. Yeah. She seems so calm, so collected. Her idea was so focused. She is such a, you know, she talks about her home life. I know it's such a silly thing to say, but she seems to have such a comfortable home life, too, with a husband she works with, you know, well, it looks like.
And
a nice kid who's being raised in the business. She seems to be in a very comfortable place mentally to take this competition.
Yeah. So I agree with you on the Brooke Shirley. I think I like Sylvia because I think she I see a lot of potential in kind of what she can do. I think the first episode shows that there's maybe not enough refinement in what it takes to succeed at Top Chef, but I think she'll adapt quickly. And then we might start to see some of the different things come out of her cooking. I mean, because, you know, we talked about how the veterans contrast to the newbies, right? And so I think once she becomes a little bit more veteran, if she stays around long enough, we might see something interesting.
I'd like to see Sylvia do well. I have personal bias because I love Italian food. But if she made an underseasoned first dish, and if she made an underseasoned pasta of all things, I'm a little worried about her. Right. Just because both of her dishes, neither of them had any kind of refinement or finesse to them. So I'm still leaning towards Brooke.
Yeah. Oh, no. I think Brooke's going to win as well.
My honorable mention is Shirley. I think you said that too.
Yeah.
Shirley's so cool, calm, and collected on top of things. And Silva, the reason I said Silva was just because Silva works for Jean-Georges.
Yeah.
And has been brought up in a Jean-Georges world, which is really one of those worlds that is the best at working with different ingredients on the fly and making something really brilliant out of them. And we had a Jean-Georges protege winner last season.
Yeah. Now, I'm looking forward to interesting episodes where they create some additional chaos in something like Restaurant Wars between these groups. I'm hoping we don't see like the rookies eliminated right away because
I kind of want to see the rookies. Yeah, this is an all-star season. This is a different thing they're trying out, and I want to see it play out.
Predicting a veteran goes home next week because of the producers.
All right, so who do we say who is our veteran to go home next week? Sheldon. I'm saying Sheldon. Sheldon or Casey?
Yeah.
All right, so next week, my prediction, Sheldon. I guess with yours, is just that Sheldon's going to go home, period.
Great. All right, so let's wrap up with the recipe of the week. So what we're going to be doing every week is kind of taking one of the dishes that we liked from this episode, and Peter's kind of going to put a spin and put up a recipe on the blog of something that's spiritually, I don't know, an homage to the dish. Or just something someone could make at home.
Something that'll play off it nicely.
So what are you gonna do this week?
Well, this week I decided, in tribute to the dish that I was the most scared about eating, I would like to put my spin on fried chicken livers.
Yeah.
So instead of going with the strawberry vinaigrette, which sounds interesting, I want to do chicken livers in a way that I like to do it, which is with lemon and fatty pork. That's more my speed for chicken livers. I like a really strong citrus. I like a really strong salt when I'm going to do a chicken liver. So this week we're going to do deep fried chicken livers with lemon butter, fried capers, and lardon.
Yeah.
It'll be good.
It's going to be good.
Really healthy.
Yeah, exactly. Liver's good for you, right?
Liver is actually very good for you. Lots of iron, lots of minerals, and also lots of calories.
Yeah, and then when you, bread and fry it.
Just work out before you eat this.
Exactly.
That's going to be the case a lot with these dishes, just so everyone's aware.
Great. Yeah. All right. Well, I think that's it. Again, this is our first episode, so we're definitely going to be growing and adapting and trying different new things. So definitely, if you have ideas, let us know, whether you know us personally or you can tweet at us or email us, because, maybe we'll cover Last Chance Kitchen. Maybe we'll do, We'll try some different things with, doing the recipe as a video, that sort of stuff. So
maybe we'll even teach you how to make a strawberry vinaigrette.
Oh, Peter, it'll just be me making the strawberry vinaigrette, and Peter's just going to be in the back, like, stewing.
Maybe this week, instead of doing the fried livers, actually, I should just make a panzanella so that everyone actually knows what that is. Because that was kind of painful.
Burn.
Maybe we'll do a double recipe this week.
Like Jamie, except not overburn. Great. So that's what for this week's episode of Deconstructed. If you like this episode, please sure to give us a like and comment on iTunes. Peter's recipe of the week can be found on our blog, which you can find at nkrn.org/deconstructed. And as always, you can tweet comments, ideas, and complaints to us on Twitter at deconstructpod, because deconstructed pod is too many characters. So that's it. And unlike Gerald, you don't have to pack up your knives and go, but you can't stay here. We'll catch everyone next week. Later.
Later.
Deconstructed, the Top Chef podcast, is brought to you by the Nerdy Knights Network. For more great content, visit nkrn.org. Our theme music was brought to you by podcastthemes.com. If you're interested in becoming a sponsor for the show, please tweet at us at nerdy_knights.